Hi, I'm Junyi. I'm the director of Q-SEnSE, which is a National Science Foundation-funded quantum center of Quantum Leap Challenge Institute. And Q-SEnSE stands for Quantum Systems Through Entangled Science and Engineering. Q-SEnSE is led by the University of Colorado, Boulder, and JILA, which is a joint institute between the university and the National Institute of Standards and Technology. Q-SEnSE, in fact, represents a nationwide collaboration. We have 8 universities, 3 national labs, and 1 national institute, all working together at the cutting edge of science and technology. Quantum science is a continuous spectrum, ranging from quantum sensing to quantum information processing, quantum networking. By focusing on quantum sensing, we hope to realize some of the near-term goals that quantum revolution will bring to our nation.
Something that is amazing of Q-SEnSE is the capability to talk between experiment and theory. A breakthrough is possible thanks to these very tight collaborations, the possibility to have a center where students are trained in a collaboration, that they are not only talking to my group or groups at JILA, but they have the capability to talk with groups at MIT and Stanford. This is crucial. My group tried to understand the rules that determine the behavior of atom molecules and ions, for example. And what we try to do is to develop models that can guide experiments to create better sensors or better quantum simulators. We want to use the unique capabilities of the quantum world to develop sensors that we would have never imagined we could build. The atoms have only specific energies that we can excite them with. So what happens is that this discrete nature of the atomic levels allow us to use specific frequencies of photons to excite them. The interesting part is that quantum atoms are indistinguishable, but at the same time, because they're indistinguishable and ruled by the quantum nature, by quantum mechanics, then atoms are extremely noisy. But if we are able to entangle the atoms, then what happens is that we can shape the noise and reduce the noise and make them better sensors.
Experiments are trying to observe this interesting behavior in many different quantum platforms. So we're trying to find a way of making this behavior manifest and be able to see it and model it theoretically.
Working in collaboration with experiments, it's the best part of my work, is to see that a theory is not just some technical or some equations written in paper, but actually to see the predictions that we make, observe in the laboratory, and not only observe, but help to improve the sensor is amazing.
A physicist's goal is really to answer a core scientific question that we don't have an answer to. And an engineer's goal is to solve a problem for which we don't have a solution. To have Q-SEnSE bring those two states of mind together has helped us to bridge technology in a way that I don't think has been possible before. This is the Precision Laser Diagnostics Laboratory. I'm sitting in front of the next generation of frequency comb lasers and electro-optic sampling systems that we're going to be using to sense and detect and differentiate molecules in flames, in the atmosphere, in different environments.
This is all special optical equipment that we have built up to manipulate light. We're doing all of this manipulation because we want to have a very specific output that we can use to measure how particular gases interact with light.
Normal lasers emit, you know, a single wavelength of light, like red or green. Frequency combs emit hundreds of thousands or even millions of colors of light, individual frequencies. We've been doing work in the oil and gas industry where we've taken these tools and translated them out, even spun out a company that senses methane emissions from the oil and gas industry.
Light is something that we use constantly to see every day, so the fact that we can take light and manipulate it in this way to do cool experiments is just fascinating.
This setup is going to allow us to, you know, detect molecules that have been really hard to detect before, that have strong implications on, you know, particulate matter that enters into our air through chemical processing and can be harmful to people, or that we need to understand and reduce when we're designing the processes. It's phenomenally exciting to be part of the first group that's taking this technology and really turning it towards applications that the general public can benefit from.
The University of Colorado Boulder is one of the best places in the world to work on quantum science and engineering. And that's because we have so many excellent people working on the different aspects here. Students are critical to everything we do. That it's not enough just to do the really super cool experiments in our labs, but we need to train people. We need the next generation of students, scientists who are going to go on and make the next discoveries to teach the students the critical skills that they would need in our new quantum economy. I build measurement tools that enable astronomers every night to look at stars, search for exoplanets, characterize those planets so that in future missions we could use tools like the James Webb Telescope to look for signatures of life on those planets.
The main purpose is to find exoplanets, which is like really cool.
We use a tool called an optical frequency comb. And that optical frequency comb is like a ruler for light. So it allows us to make the most precise measurements ever of the wavelength or the color of light that would be coming from a star. We can't see that planet even with our strongest telescopes, but we can see the impact of that planet gently tugging on the star, moving the star to and fro. And when that happens, the color of the star changes ever so minutely. A big emphasis of my position here in the College of Engineering is to take the really amazing science discovery that's been made and translate those out and work with companies on solutions that companies could actually build, commercialize, and sell. There's really real need for innovation in doing that. It's been a real privilege, and it's an enhancement to our research to be able to collaborate with scientists here locally, within Q-SEnSE on the university campus, but also at NIST, very important partners in quantum metrology, but then other partners across the country. The Quantum Engineering Initiative, the QEI, is a new outgrowth that's working together with Q-SEnSE and the larger environment, Qubit, to translate scientific discovery into technological devices, tools that can be used outside the research lab. So this is really a complete ecosystem here, where we have the impact, the influence of NSF's investment in Q-SEnSE is impacting not just the basic science, but really the translation of the science to engineering through places like the QEI out into real world, into our new growing quantum economy.
We build some of the most precise atomic clocks in existence today. Time is important for modern communication networks, for navigation systems, for national security, for commerce, and so on. Also, it's a place where we test some of the most advanced concepts of quantum physics and technologies, such as lasers, such as cold atoms, such as quantum antibody physics, and so on.
In order to make this atomic clock, we need a really ultra-cold source of atoms in order to probe. So all the optics here are for making that ultra-cold source of atoms.
As we want to continue to push on the state-of-the-art of atomic clocks, we want to use more and more atoms in the system. The more atoms you have, the stronger this quantum signal we will have to build a better atomic clock. However, when you have a lot of people in the room, you know, people tend to talk to each other. Atoms do the same. They like to talk to each other and distract each other's attention, which in clock business would mean a frequency shift. Or a clock you build is no longer accurate.
All this light here is specifically tuned to cool the atoms and trap them in a lattice of light. So adjusting optics here will improve or hurt our total atom number and essentially make the clock better or worse.
There are many, many hallelujah moments because when the technology works, there are moments of several days when the machine is humming along really beautifully. And a good data just comes out and it really tells you, yeah, what you had in mind actually worked. It's almost like an excuse to do really good science. It really does open up a new opportunity to look into the most fundamental aspect of the physics. there are still a lot of unknown physics out there in the universe, a lot of mysteries still out there. And so clocks could be one of the best human-made instruments that's most sensitive to explore the unknown corners of the universe.
My lab works broadly in the area of atomic clocks, at least within the context of Q-SEnSE. My group works in a particular way, which is newer, which uses optical tweezers. These optical tweezer systems allow us to manipulate not only the atoms in a very isolated way, we can improve how quickly we can measure time by putting the atoms in particular quantum states that are so-called entangled. And that entanglement allows us to overcome some key challenges in the rate at which we can perform measurements.
So this is our strontium tweezer experiment. Using all of these lasers and coils and stuff that you see, we have so much control over these atoms that we can kind of make them behave like other physical systems.
We have a microscope into which we shine a laser beam. And that laser beam is focused by the microscope through a small window into a vacuum chamber that is more vacuous than space. In order to get the atoms trapped, we cool them down with lasers, which is a technique that JILA has been pioneering in for some time. While they're isolated, we can cause them to interact, and those interactions allow us to prepare quantum states of interest that improve the atomic clock. And that's something that we've been very excited about and recently achieved.
In our research over the years, we've focused on the motion of the atom in the optical tweezer. The optical tweezer is like a bowl, and the atom can roll back and forth inside of it. Sometimes that rolling can cause detrimental effects for using the neutral atom as a quantum bit. And sometimes it can just be fun to explore different ways that we can put the atom in certain quantum states of its motion that you couldn't get classically. In our experiment here, what we're doing is we're figuring out how to hold on to not a bunch of atoms, not the atoms whizzing around in our atmosphere as we stand here right now, but really single atoms, in particular single rubidium atoms.
We're trying to combine optical tweezer in a cryogenic environment, which is what you're hearing in the background, that is cryogenic refrigerator working.
Here we're making a very specialized vacuum apparatus where we can hold on to single atoms in the optical tweezers, and we can try to have them live for much longer times than you would typically have in these type of systems.
One thing exciting about this experiment is right now there's not a lot of people doing these sort of things, combining cryogenic with optical tweezers.
Apparati like you see here are getting more and more complicated. So really within academia, we have to focus on the clever tricks that we can come up with to simplify the scientific thinking, and also to work with students and postdocs to come up with ever-evolving ways to think about these systems.
Thank you for your time and for watching some of the highlights coming out of our Quantum Science and Technology Center here at Q-SEnSE. Many exciting scientific engineering results have come out of the center. But perhaps the most important part is we have trained great students who are becoming the next generations of leaders in quantum science and technology for our academic institutions, for the national labs, and for many quantum companies.